Hello everyone, I am Dr. Ravi, Assistant Professor under MPI 33, Department of Mechanical Engineering, Engineering College, Bikaner. Today I am here to discuss the topic selection of refrigerants. Before go through the topic selection of refrigerant, I just remind the previous lecture in which we covered the topics like history of the refrigerants, refrigeration principles, what is refrigerants, classification of refrigerations, and nomenclature of refrigerants. So today lecture, selection of refrigerants criteria. The selection of refrigerants for a particular application is based upon the following equipments. The first is thermodynamic and thermophysical properties. Second, environmental and safety properties. And the third one is economics. The thermodynamic and thermophysical properties, and these properties requirements are, first is suction pressure. At a given evaporator temperature, the saturation pressure should be above atmospheric for prevention of air or moisture ingress into the system and ease of the leak detections. This means that given evaporative temperature, the refrigerant selected should have a positive pressure. This means the operating pressure or evaporated pressure should have above atmospheric. This is required because if there is any leakage take place from the system to surrounding, that means the refrigerant leaks out from the system. And this is easier to handle than the reverse scale. This means the system is operating under vacuum, then either moisture from outside leak into the system. So this is difficult to handle because in order to remove the air or moisture, we have to do complete overhauling of the system. Also, if the system is operating under vacuum, then the detection of leak is difficult. So for as possible, the refrigerant should have a positive pressure at evaporated temperature. Here the suction pressure is better as it leads to smaller compressor displacement. This means that, as we know, when the suction pressure is higher at a given temperature, then the density will be high or the specific volume will be low. That means for a given mass storage, the required size of compressor will be small. And for other reasons, the suction pressure should always as a high as possible. This is the first requirement for any ideal refrigerant. Then the second point is discharge pressure. At a given condenser temperature, the discharge pressure should be as small as possible to allow lightweight construction of compressor, condenser, etc. This is because once it is low, we get maximum operating pressure of the system, and will be low because that is decided to the condenser pressures. Once the maximum operating pressure is low, means the tube stores in for the condenser and the material chosen for compressors need not to be heavy. That means you can go for a thinner tubes. This reduces the cost and this reduces the weight of the system. So this is very important requirement. Also, the pressure ratio will be small when the condenser pressure is small. So next point is, third is pressure ratio, which is interlinking with the discharge pressures, which is nothing but the ratio of the condenser pressure to the evaporator pressure should be as small as possible for high volumetric efficiency and low pressure consumptions. low power consumption. Fourth is latent heat of vaporization. The latent heat of vaporization should be as large as possible so that the required mass flow rate per unit cooling capacity will be small. So continue the latent heat of vaporization. The above requirements are somewhat contradictory because operating pressure temperatures, latent heat of vaporization are related to the Clausius-Clapeyron equations. So that equation we know, that is natural log ln or T saturated is equal to minus of HF G divided by capital T plus S of F G divided by capital R. So we know that in Clausius-Clapeyron equation that is given by the expression as shown in natural log P saturated is equal to the minus HF of G by RT plus SF of G by R, where HFG is the latent heat of vaporization, SF of G is the entropy of the vaporization, R is the gas constant and T is the absolute temperature. So using this equation we find that this term that is entropy of the vaporization is does not really change much, since the entropy of vaporization is almost constant. So when the entropy of the system is always constant, then the evaporated pressure ratio is, so we have an equation that is pressure ratio is, that is P, is PC divided by P is equal to exponential, that is P x P bracket start H F of G divided by capital R bracket 1 divided by T E minus 1 divided by T C bracket closed. So in this equation the condenser pressure, that is PC, is divided by the evaporated pressure PE, which is equal to the exponential of H of G by R multiplied by 1 by TE minus 1 by TC if the evaporator and condensers are fixed. So if the evaporator and condenser temperatures are fixed, then you see if this temperature are fixed, then you see the pressure ratio increase as the latent heat means, that is as the this one, that is at the latent heat HF of G, latent heat of vaporization is increased. This means if you want to have a refrigerant with high latent of heat, that is H of G is high, the vaporization, the penalty you have to pay is in form of high compression ratio. That means if the latent heat of vaporization is increased, then the compression, the refrigerant require a high compression ratio and high pressure ratio. So at a high pressure ratio, as you know, the low volumetric efficiency and low volumetric capacity. So on the other hand, if you want to have a low low pressure ratio, then the latent heat of the vaporization will be low. That means the required mass of the weight for a given capacity of the refrigerant system will be high. That means you have a handle large amount of mass. But this is again a disadvantage. So this shows that the certain trade-off of requirements between pressure ratio and latent heat of vaporization. In other words, it required between the COP and volumetric efficiency. So further, the next property is isentropic index of compression. The isentropic index of compression should be small so that the compression discharge temperature will be low. Next is liquid specific heat. The liquid specific heat should be small so that the degree of subcooling will be large, leading to the smaller amount of flash gas at evaporator inlet. So we need small liquid specific heat. The next point is specific heat vapors. The specific heat should be large so that the degree of superheating will be small. We know that when the degree of superheating is large, the suction temperature will be high. So once the suction temperature is high, when we increase the suction temperatures, the density of refrigerant and the entry of the density of refrigerant and the entry to the compressor will be low. This means we require a large compressor for a given mass rate. This is not really good for a practical consideration. So as far as specific heat concentration, we should have a high value of specific heat, but the liquid specific heat should be low. Again, you find that this is contradictory. So it is not possible to have a very high vapor specific heat and low liquid specific heat. Now the next point is liquid and vapor thermal conductivity. Both liquid and vapor thermal conductivity should be as high as possible for higher heat transfer coefficient. The next thermodynamic property is liquid and vapor capacity. The viscosity of both liquid and vapor should be as small as possible for smaller frictional pressure drop. So we find that the thermodynamic properties are actually interrelated, and they are mainly depends on the normal boiling point and the critical temperature and the molecular structures. The normal boiling point indicates the useful temperature level, as it is directly related to the operating pressure. So this is very important properties. So next property is critical temperatures. The critical temperature, the effect of critical temperature, if the critical temperature is very high, it yields higher COP due to COP coefficient of performance due to smaller compressor superheat and smaller flash gas losses. So this is the advantages of having high critical temperatures. In critical temperature, there are some points, that is, so when the critical temperature is high, we find the vapor pressure will be low. Once vapor pressure is low, volumetric capacity will be low. So it is observed that for most of the refrigerants, the ratio of normal boiling point to the critical temperature is in the range of 0.6 to 0.7. That means the ratio is almost constant for most of the fluids. So this is the disadvantage of having high critical temperature, that give rise to higher COP, and at the same point it give rise to lower volumetric capacity. Again, you have to do a trade-off between the volumetric capacity and the COP, and for choose the critical temperature accordingly, this implies need for a trade-off between the high COP and high volumetric capacity. So next point is, this means that the normal boiling point is also a good indicator of the critical temperature of a refrigerant. This means we have a use an absolute temperature scale. Then we use using the absolute temperature scale for normal boiling point and the critical temperature, we find that the ratio is about 0.6 to 0.7. The next point is freezing point. The freezing point of a fluid should be lower than the lower temperature that you encountered while operating the refrigerant system, so refrigeration system. This is required, otherwise the refrigerant may freeze while flowing through the system. So that's all for today's lecture, and in today's lecture we have discussed only the thermodynamic properties of the refrigerants. So rest of the properties we discussed in the next lecture. Till then, thank you.